Hachette Audio presents A Brief History of Portugal by Jeremy Black, read by Roger Davis. Preface. One of the most interesting of Europe's countries, a nation of charming people, a landscape with historic cities and sandy beaches, Portugal has a long history of links with Britain and is visited by many British people. There are indeed some similarities between the geographies and cultures of the two countries. On the same time zone, they each were mighty empires, and for most of the last 6.5 centuries, their alliance has been significant to both. However, despite the interest and importance of the Portuguese exploration of much of the world in the 15th and 16th centuries, including the maritime route to India, the Portuguese Empire, and of such vivid episodes as the Lisbon earthquake of 1755, Portugal's history and that of Portugal's world are generally unknown in Britain, or indeed by most non-Portuguese people. Outside Portugal, its history is not widely taught, or usually ever taught at school or university level, or covered in film or television. I do not recall Portugal once being mentioned when I did history at school, or indeed in the first 2 years of my course at Cambridge. Whereas the history of Spain, Portugal's only neighbouring state, has attracted much international attention over the last 40 years, and there has been a marked increase in Britain in learning Spanish and in Spanish food and culture, none has been true for Portugal. That is a mistake, for Portugal is a fascinating country and with an interesting history. This audiobook is designed to provide a succinct history aimed at the tourist. The intention is to be comprehensive yet accessible. It will range across Portugal's history and geography. Allowing for this, the audiobook will devote particular attention to three aspects: Portugal's global role, its historic links with Britain, and the history and character of Portugal's principal regions. The global impact is clear. Indeed, as a result particularly of past rule in Brazil, Portuguese today is the 6th most widely spoken language in the world, after Chinese, Hindi, English, Spanish, and Arabic. The global role first begins with the Portuguese age of exploration in the 15th century, notably with Prince Henry the Navigator and Vasco da Gama. This was not an age of discovery, as the peoples reached knew they were there, while Europeans were already aware that India existed. But there was an exploration of new routes and the discovery of peoples unknown to Europeans, notably those of Brazil. Portugal was the first of the Atlantic empires, and also opened up the direct sea route from Europe to Asia, a route later to be followed by the Dutch and the English. Fishing the Atlantic, the settlement of Madeira, the Azores, and the Cape Verde Islands, and the exploration of the west coast of Africa, were followed from the mid-16th century onwards by a global empire that reached from Macau in China and Timor in the East Indies via Malacca or Malaysia, Goa, other Indian positions and bases in Sri Lanka, to Mombasa, Mozambique, other bases in East Africa, Angola, bases in West Africa, and then on to Brazil. Portugal had a major world empire until the loss of Brazil in the 1820s, Indian possessions until 1961, an African empire until 1975, and a surviving foothold in Asia until Macau was returned to China in 1999. What remains territorially are only the Azores and Madeira. But what also remains, both in Portugal and more widely, is the legacy of a world empire, indeed of a particular type of world empire, a conflation of people, food, ideas, language, religion, culture, and an opening up to the outside that has left Portugal very different from much of southern Europe, including those other imperial powers, Spain and Italy. As England's oldest ally, Portugal benefited from English help in the bloody tasks of conquering Lisbon from Moorish rule in 1147 and in opposing Castile in the 14th century. English longbowmen played a crucial part in the warfare of the 1380s, and notably in the Battle of Aljubarrota in 1385. The English went on to play a key military role in Portuguese history in the 1580s, 1660s, 1700s, 1760s, 1808 to 1813, and the 1820s. Whereas in the 1580s, Philip II of Spain was accepted by a substantial part of Portuguese society, from the 1660s, English musketeers continued the early role of the archers in helping to secure Portugal's liberties. Portugal remained an important ally for Britain, and the British wish that Portugal would accept this role was generally, but not always, reciprocated. Portugal was even an informal member of the British Empire throughout the 19th century, albeit a forced one, as when George Canning remarked, "Portugal must always be English." Indeed, the ultimatum in 1890, as we will hear in Chapter 10, was scarcely the product of a harmonious agreement over goals. Trade was very important to Anglo-Portuguese relations, economic and political. This trade took English, later British, goods to Portugal, notably woolen cloth from the Middle Ages and coal in the 19th century. From Portugal and its empire came most famously port and gold, the former leaving a noted legacy in the repertoire of British drinks, the latter from Brazil, important to the solvency of the British Empire in the 18th century. More recently, large-scale British tourism has developed, notably to the Algarve. Alongside the sun, beaches and golf there, Portugal for the British also means the major cruise stops in Lisbon, Oporto, Madeira and the Azores, the development of cruise holidays on the Douro, and city breaks to Lisbon and Oporto. Each of these have become popular. Moreover, it seems apparent that British tourism will remain important to the Portuguese. Past affection. On the 13th of May, 1762, the London Chronicle reported, "There is no state upon earth of which the Portuguese entertain so high an opinion as of ours, nor any people of whom they think or speak as well as of the English, whether in a collective sense as a nation or an individual one as traders, while there are no nations or people which they equally hate with the French and Spaniards. So that in spite of all their blind bigotry in religion, by which they are made to hate us as heretics, as a state or as traders, their own interest and experience have attached them to us in the strongest manner." National stereotypes are always dangerous, if not misleading, and reading those of the past is to be struck by how much they date. Equally, it is worth noting the very frequent contrasting by British travellers of the Portuguese with the Spaniards, and always to the favour of the former, who are generally presented as more relaxed and more friendly, the two being closely linked. The history of Portugal's regions reflects in part their distinctive character and also the interest of this very varied country. From the mountainous north to the cliffs and beaches of the Algarve in the south, from the mainland to the islands, Portugal is well worth visiting. The regions have the common history that is Portugal, but also different experiences, and their varied background provides tourists with a happy diversity within a relatively small space. Moreover, although some of the driving can be frightening and minor roads can be poor, it is easier to drive across Portugal than in the past. Visiting Portugal on numerous occasions from 1990, I have always met with a friendly reception. This audiobook is a small way of repaying that debt. Chapter 1. Introduction. The geography of Portugal explains its character. The interior is difficult to cultivate, with terrain and climate key problems, and repeatedly so. Yet Portugal also has a long coastline. Indeed, for a part of a continental landmass, it has a high ratio of coastline to land area. If not as high as Denmark, the ratio is far higher than that for Spain. Moreover, while much of the country is close to the coast, An appreciable percentage is also close to rivers that flow there, and notably the mighty Tagus, of which the extensive estuary provides the foreground for Lisbon. The major cities, Lisbon and Oporto, are ports, and across its over 500 miles of coastline, the country looks out to the Atlantic. Nearly half of the population lives in the Atlantic coastal strip, from Braga in the north to Setúbal south of Lisbon. Unlike for Spain, France and Britain, no other sea shares Portugal's attention. For most of its history, from the 6th century BCE, before Common Era, or BC, before Christ, the near ocean offered fish, a plentiful source of protein and vitamins, albeit one that exposed fishermen to the threatening rollers and storms of the Atlantic and to the hard work of working its waters. Fish quays and markets, as in Lisbon, offer much for tourists to see. The fish auctions at Cascais and Sesimbra after the day's catch has been brought in being of particular interest. The freshness of the fish can make nearby restaurants particularly appealing. The broader horizon of the apparently limitless Atlantic, however, suggested limits, not opportunities, for a long time. Indeed, until the 15th century. Instead of being different, the population was affected by the broader currents of the history of the Iberian Peninsula and had many similarities with that of Spain, with which it has an 800-mile border, a border that since independence in the 12th century has always posed issues. For much of its history, Portugal had no obvious rationale, geographical or otherwise, for being treated as a separate entity. Indeed, its existence is purely the result of socio-political processes that date from no earlier than the 9th and 10th centuries, and that led, as a result of happenstance, to a separate political entity from the 12th century. Thus, there is no distinct nor distinctive Portugal before the creation of that state. Instead, like the rest of Iberia, Portugal experienced Roman conquest, Christianization, Visigothic conquest, the Muslim takeover, the driving out of the Muslims, and the consolidation of a new kingdom. As in Spain, most of the population lived on the land and from agriculture. Both were part of the Iberian Peninsula, Portugal constituting about one-sixth of it. Portugal has no other borders. Yet the details of geography helped ensure that although there was nothing to match the strength of regional identity and politics in Spain, with its far more divided history and greater size, nevertheless there were important variations in the pattern of Portugal's character. These will be discussed in greater detail in chapters 13 to 16, the regional part of the audiobook, but essentially, the mountainous, colder north contrasts with the drier south. However, as we will hear, there are many other significant qualifications and variations. Each of these contributes to the fascination of Portugal and its 10 million inhabitants. A key element, however, across much of Portugal is the varied difficulty of the environment and, in particular, of the soil, although there are major exceptions, including in Extremadura, notably near the Tagus. That harshness affects agricultural yields. Combined with the rocky terrain, this means that part of the country is not terribly suitable for farming, most clearly in the highest mountain range in mainland Portugal, the Serra da Estrela. However, this is not only a problem in high areas. Instead, repeatedly across Portugal, the rocks stick through the thin soil. In addition, particularly in the north, the slopes can frequently be very steep. That contributes to the picturesque quality of the vineyards in the Douro Valley, but they are very difficult to work and certainly cannot be picked by machine. The profits from the sale of port ensure that hand-picking is economic, although it also pushes up costs. Indeed, the difficulties posed by the steepness of the slopes across much of Portugal can be seen in the shape of abandoned farms, neglected terracing, and deserted farmsteads. In contrast come the lush grassland plains near the Tagus, for example the Lisiria, an area noted for horse breeding and for the breeding of bulls for the popular sport of bullfighting. An inherent inefficiency in some of the agriculture has been exposed, both since Portugal joined the EEC by a serious exposure to competition, and because the challenge of mechanisation, which is not really so practical on stony soils, became more significant as agriculture elsewhere in Europe embraced machinery. As a result, there has been an abandonment of many fields that are on steep slopes, and especially of wheat production. Depopulation had been particularly acute in the rural areas of the north and the Beirish, and this continues to be the case. Portuguese dualism, the interior versus the coast, has been a long-standing structural feature of the country. Urbanisation in the 1950s and 1960s speeded up the process, which has continued since. Much else testifies to the challenges posed by the environment. Moreover, these can remain very difficult. Fire is a major hazard and was notably so in June and October 2017 and July 2019. The heat of the summer and the readily inflammable nature of the woodland contribute to such cataclysms. Floods, in contrast, have become less of a problem. They used to be very serious, notably on the Douro before it was regulated by dams, but also on smaller rivers such as the Tâmega. The frequent flooding of the Mondego in Coimbra forced the closure of the Santa Clara convent in 1677 and its movement to a new site uphill. There were regular floods of the Tagus, notably near Santarém. The high water marks in riverside towns such as Amarante are a clear legacy of floods, as are centres that were built safely above the riverbank, such as Régua on the Douro. The Portuguese can make sardonic remarks about their climate, on the lines of 9 months of winter and 3 months of hell. It can certainly be too hot to do much, and tourists, whether or not familiar with heat, are advised to pace themselves, especially, but not only, in the summer, and notably so as they go further south. In the south, the buildings are often of clay, are whitewashed in order to help repel the sun, and have few openings in order to keep the summer heat out. Moreover, there is frequent heavy rain in northern Portugal, both up to March and sometimes until May and after September. Without the rain, there would not be greenery and agriculture, because most of the agriculture does not have the benefit of irrigation, which is less developed than in Spain. In between, however, there is much good weather. April and May are the best months for travel because the weather is good, but the massive crowds that descend in the summer have not yet arrived. With recent trends, June is now one of the very busy months. As the crowds ease, September is also good. It can still have the summer heat while it is drier than the spring. The Algarve and Madeira attract many visitors in the winter, but not the Azores, which can be stormy as well as wet. For a Brit, the winter across central and northern Portugal may be wet, and a wet day in Oporto can be very wet and windy, but it is milder than in Britain. I have had a wonderful holiday in Lisbon and its environs in December, with clear skies and weather that was both calm and warm enough to permit lunch outdoors. All year round, Portugal has much to offer. The conveniences of the present, from heaters to air conditioning, spare the modern tourist many of the discomforts of his or her predecessors. So also with refrigeration for food preservation, the rapid distribution of food by road, road surfaces that permit smooth journeys, and the speed of modern vehicles. They shrink the country, but it still repays the detailed eye. Chapter 2. Prehistory and Classical Portugal. The Stone Age to the End of the Roman Era. Early Settlement. Portugal has a long history of human settlement. Early hominids lived there, and archaeological research over the last 30 years has provided fascinating evidence, even if the broader picture, as for other countries, can be elusive. Homo antecessor, the archaic Homo sapiens, were followed by Neanderthals and then by Cro-Magnon humans, the origins of modern Homo sapiens. There is evidence of the coexistence of Neanderthals and Cro-Magnon humans, and in 1999, just north of Lisbon, a Paleolithic skeleton with a legacy from both was discovered. Initially cave dwellers, the Cro-Magnon humans, were able to range widely, using stone and composite tools, not least as weapons, and they developed skills accordingly. Cave drawings survive in the Grutes dos Caral in the Alentejo from around 15,000 BCE and in the archaeological park of the Coa Valley. As in France and Spain, animals play an important role in these drawings. Early carvings can be seen in Oporto's Suas dos Reis Museum. The Grutes das Lapas caves near Torres Novas were occupied in Neolithic times. The ice ages provided major issues of adaptation as the climate cooled. Portugal was not covered in the ice sheet that shrouded much of northern Europe. Nevertheless, it was affected by the major fall in temperature, by its savage effect on growing seasons, and by the falling of the sea level due to the freezing of water near the poles. The subsequent rise in the temperature after the ice ages ended in about 10,000 BCE saw far more benign environments for plants, and in part as a result, for animal life. Humans benefited, both as hunters and as gatherers, and the population rose. Larger mammals, however, could be badly affected by climate change, and were also hunted to extinction. Evidence of hunter-gatherers has been found from around Alcácer even earlier, indeed back to the Mesolithic period, about 40,000 years ago. The Sardu estuary was exploited, including in searching for shellfish, a practice also seen in Japanese coastal waters. In turn, cereal cultivation spread, with the domestication of wild crops and their propagation. There was also a domestication of animals that led to sheep and goat herding. As a consequence, the roaming and foraging lives of hunter-gatherers came to overlap and then be replaced by more sedentary lifestyles. Thanks to the more intensive agriculture, villages that were probably inhabited year-long were established, for example on hilltops in the lower Tagus Valley in about 5000 BCE. Their setting provided protection. Such settlements saw the development of craft skills and trade, and had the manpower for building and for concerted activity. Stone monuments, including megaliths around Évora and more generally in the Alentejo, are an important legacy. Particularly impressive is the Cromelech dos Almendres, a far-flung oval of 95 granite monoliths 10 miles west of Évora, surrounded by a cork oak forest, and nearby the Menhir dos Almendres and the Antegrand do Sampugeiro, Europe's largest dolmen, a single-chamber megalithic tomb. The remains from the last site are in Évora's museum. These megaliths indicate the sophistication of a society that used such sites for ritual practices and for astronomy. A considerable level of organization is suggested by such works. There are also megalithic burial chambers in the region around Lisbon, although permanent settlements do not leave an archaeological trace until about 2500 BCE. The first known native people of Portugal date from the Late Bronze Age, 1100 to 700 BCE. Known as the Estrimnius, Latin Estrimni, they had fortified settlements in the valleys and on the estuaries of central Portugal. The archaeological record improves with the Iron Age, during which Celtic peoples, having crossed the Pyrenees, moved into Portugal in about 700 BCE. Building fortified hill villages or citenias, such as San Fins de Freire near Santo Tirso, a walled settlement with about 100 huts. A key example is the Citenia de Briteiros, between Braga and Guimarães, which was inhabited from about 300 BCE. Protected by walls and supported by a water distribution system, it contained over 150 stone huts linked by paved paths. The site, which includes reconstructed huts, can be visited, while remains can be seen in Guimarães in the archaeological museum named after Martin Sarmento, who excavated the site, and also in his manor house. The former has Celtic sarcophagi and decorative stones from the Celt-Iberian bathhouses of the region. To the northwest, on the Mount of Santa Lucia near Viana do Castelo, the ruins of another Cetenia can be visited. Further south, Alcácer do Sal on the River Sado originated as an Iron Age hill fort, so also with Linares and Monsanto. The defensive character of such sites is readily apparent, not least in providing warnings of raiders. The sites served to protect people, their grain stores and their animals. So also with the defensive possibilities of Almurol, an island in the Tagus, where there was an Iron Age fort that was to be conquered and occupied by the Romans. Museums hold important material from the Iron Age. The regional archaeological museum in Suevi has bronze tools, grinding stones, which were crucial for milling grain, and jewellery. The Museum of Don Diogo de Souza in Braga holds arrowheads, ceramics, and funerary objects. It is difficult to determine the relationship between the Celts and the pre-existing tribes. Alongside different cultural groups, there was probably much overlap, not least due to intermarriage, but in both cases, there are many difficulties involved in classification and in its application. Changes across time also entail questions about the causation of change. Phoenicians and Greeks. The nature of the available archaeological and later written records direct attention to external links and foreign intervention in Portugal. While important, these links and intervention can, however, lead to a serious underplaying of indigenous developments. The Iron Age saw the establishment of a Phoenician presence with a nearby Phoenician mercantile base at Gadir, or Cadiz, from about 800 BCE. Precious metals, especially copper, iron, tin, gold and silver, were their goal and were well worth the journey. Tin was important for the production of bronze. There were Phoenician colonies in Abul and Alcácer. Influence was not restricted to the coast. For example, the Rio Arad provided a river route into the Algarve, along which copper and iron could be transported for export. At Mértola on the river Guadiana, the Phoenicians had an inland trading position. Further north, there was another at Alcácer do Sal. Each were to be municipalities where the citizens had old Latin rites during the Roman Empire. In return for the precious metals, the Phoenicians brought Mediterranean goods, such as wine and textiles. Trade, moreover, became the means for technological and cultural transmission. In the 8th century BCE, the Phoenicians established a position in Lisbon, which they called Alis Ubo, or Calm Harbour. The site was on the southern slope of the Castle Hill. There may also have been a Greek trading station there, and the Greeks appear to have established a presence in Portugal in the 6th century BCE. Their trade was similar to that of the Phoenicians. Indeed, the Latin name for Lisbon, Olisipo, was said in late antique and Phoenician tradition to derive from the fact that Ulysses went there in his wanderings. Phoenician influences came to be directed by Carthage, a dynamic Phoenician settlement near modern Tunis. It became a major power and established a significant presence in southern and eastern Spain, but not in distant Portugal, although the latter was probably within the ambit of Carthaginian commercial influence. Carthaginian attempts at conquest were allegedly unsuccessful. Roman conquest. Having conquered the Carthaginian bases and territories in Spain during the Second Punic War, 218 to 201 BCE, Carthage's nemesis, Rome, eventually sought to extend its power across the entire peninsula. From the Guadalquivir Valley in nearby Andalusia from 208 BCE, the Romans began to press on nearby southern Portugal. Yet the Romans found that there was a major difference between overthrowing another foreign imperial presence in the shape of Carthage and subjugating the rest of Iberia. The former was more vulnerable to attack and more focused on cities, notably ports, that could be besieged. The targets in the remainder of Iberia were far more diffuse. This helps explain the length of time it took for the Romans to conquer Portugal, but there were more significant issues. Notably, the culture of conquest and, separately, alternative commitments. The republican system, with its annual consulates and praetorships, functioned to give the office holders brief opportunities for military glory, ideally winning triumphs as well as the profits to be made from war, including slaves. So it was in the interests of the ruling elite in Rome to win victories and take loot, but at the same time, keep the war going almost indefinitely. The same situation occurred later in the early Islamic period. The Umayyads could, in practice, have eliminated the small Christian states in the north in the 8th, 9th, and 10th centuries, but needed them as targets for annual campaigning to advertise their credentials as Islamic rulers. Returning to the long time the Roman conquest took, Rome, having defeated Carthage, was drawn into a series of wars with Macedon that left it in control of Greece, but that had absorbed much of Rome's energy through to 148 BCE. There were also other major struggles, including war further east with the Seleucid king Antiochus in 192 to 189 BCE, as well as the Third Punic War with Carthage, 149 to 146 BCE. Nevertheless, Rome made gains in this period in Iberia, and these gains were followed in 139 to 133 BCE by the successful conquest of much of Iberia. The Lusitani, a tribal confederation, probably Celtic, between the Tagus and the Douro, had provided firm resistance from 194 BCE, notably in 147 to 139 BCE under Viriathus, but his death was followed by Roman conquest. The Roman account was that Viriathus was killed in his sleep by his companions, who had been bribed by the Romans, only for them to receive execution as their reward, on the grounds that Rome did not pay traitors. The Roman conquest involved local support, a practice also seen elsewhere. The city of Olisipo, Lisbon, provided help against the Lusitani from 138 BCE, and the Romans fortified the settlement. In 137 BCE, Roman forces moving north crossed the Douro, and the following year reached the river Minho. The Roman troops proved reluctant to cross the rivers, fearing that they were the Lethe, the river of forgetfulness. Julius Caesar, governor of Hispania Ulterior, and after whom Beja was named Pax Julia, campaigned in what is now modern Portugal north of the Tagus, conquering local tribes in 61 to 60 BCE. Aside from conquering, the Romans also faced rebellions, both from the indigenous population and, as elsewhere in the empire, from Roman rebels. With reference to Caesar's campaigns against Pompey's sons in Iberia in 45 BCE, a Roman writer noted, "In view of the constant sallies of the natives, all places which are remote from towns are firmly held by towers and fortifications. They have watchtowers in them." Resistance to Roman conquest continued in northwest Spain and northern Portugal until 17 BCE, and this impressed Roman commentators, as well as providing a way to praise their own successes. In the 19th century, this resistance attracted interest from nationalist commentators and artists engaged with the idea of an exemplary pre-Roman national origin and concerned to trace difference from Spain to pre-Roman tribes. However, there was a marked preference instead for claiming a Roman legacy and for focusing not on the resistance to the Romans, but instead on the eventually successful medieval resistance to the Muslims. The latter resistance could be presented as having an exemplary Christian character. Alongside the strength of the resistance came the many challenges to the Roman troops posed by the environment, notably those of operating in the mountains, of the climate, and of logistical support. Roman rule. By the time the conquest of Iberia was complete, Most of what would become Portugal was already part of the Roman system. Iberia was significant as a source of food and minerals, for example of gold from near Oporto. Establishing large agricultural estates, latifundios, the Romans developed viticulture and the cultivation of grain and olives. Wool and horses were other significant exports to Italy as well as elsewhere in the empire. Such estates were presumably linked to villas, a good example of which is the 1st century CE Villa Cardilho near Torres Novas. The baths survive, as do mosaics. Roads were built by the Romans, originally in order to exert power and authority, notably to move troops for conquest and counter-insurgency. Near Porta de Mos, there is a Roman road that has become a walking trail. The roads constituted a system. Road junctions, such as Bracara Augusta, Braga, became significant settlements, which in turn were crucial to the economy, and in particular to the movement of goods. From Braga, roads ran to Olisipo, the sole municipality of Roman citizens in modern Lisbon in Pliny's time, and to Astorga in Spain. The associated bridges, which were important to the system, could be impressive. The Roman bridge at Ponte de Lima, en route from Braga to Astorga, mostly dates from the 14th century, but a segment of the Roman original survives. Finished in 104 CE, the 140-metre-long Roman bridge at Chervish survives with its arches and two milestones. Not being on the Mediterranean, Roman Portugal was less well integrated into the empire than much of Spain. Lusitania, the province covering much of what would become Portugal and western Castile, had its capital at Emerita Augusta, Mérida in modern Spain, and the scale of the theatre, amphitheatre and Temple of Diana there in part reflect the tax revenues raised in Portugal. Yet, thanks to the ports, for example, modern Oporto, Lisbon, Alcácer and Alvor, goods could be exported directly from Portugal, such as salt from Vila do Conde. Moreover, there were also significant Roman building works in Portugal, notably at Conimbriga near Coimbra. Originally a Celtic settlement, this became a city on the route from Lisbon to Braga. Tourists can visit the remains of baths and luxurious villas, which have attractive mosaic floors, notably the extensive Casa das Fontes, House of Fountains. In Lisbon, where the population under the Romans may have been around 30,000, recent building work in the BCP bank has revealed the remains of a Roman fish-preserving plant, which can be seen in the Núcleo Arqueológico. Fish sauce, garum, was important to Roman cuisine and helped bring wealth to the city. Fish salting was also carried out in Setobriga, a town near Troia, where the stone tanks can be visited. Also in Lisbon are the remains of a Roman theatre dating from 57 CE and an accompanying museum which provides relevant information. Most of Roman Lisbon, however, has been destroyed and built over to a degree that there is nothing left. Buildings focused on the cities, the forcing houses of Romanization, the centres of government and of Roman religious cults, and the locations to which the wealth generated in the countryside was transferred, notably through taxes, rent and expenditure. Landowners tended to live in the cities, where Roman dress and the Latin language were adopted. Thus, Conimbriga had a forum and a bathing complex, while in Évora it is possible to visit the remains of the Roman baths, only discovered from 1987, as well as of a temple, generally referred to as a temple of Diana. In Braga there are numerous remains, including the ruins of a theatre and baths that date from the 2nd century CE, as well as the 1st century Fountain of the Idol, which was associated with a water cult dedicated to a local Lusitanian god, Tongo Embiagas. The Casa do Infante in Oporto has Roman foundations and mosaics on show. Most modern cities trace their origins to the Roman period or to the Roman development of Celtic sites. Thus, Leiria was the Roman Colipo, While Faru was Osonoba, and its archaeological museum contains a very impressive Roman mosaic. Many, such as Santarém, Roman Scalabis, were the administrative capitals of a region. However, some Roman cities did not have this legacy. Egitania is the site today of only a small village, Idenia Eveia, although the cathedral holds a large collection of Roman epigraphs. Roman remains can also be found in the shape of country villas, such as that at Pisoej, near Beja, where the mosaics and baths can be visited. As elsewhere in the empire, Romanization was much weaker in areas that were mountainous and or remote from cities, and where the economy was more a matter of subsistence and or pastoral agriculture. That description covered most of Portugal. Moreover, this distinction remained pertinent across Portugal's history. There are, however, remains in these areas. For example, the Centum Celas, a Roman tower, survives in Beira Baixa, although its function is unclear. Portugal was affected by the more general developments of the Roman Empire, ranging from politics to the spread of disease. Knowledge about Portugal spread, thus it is covered in the Geographica of the Greek geographer Strabo, about 63 BCE to 24 CE, who was born in modern-day Turkey and wrote about the known world. Strabo referred to the wealth of Iberia as having attracted conquerors, and to Iberia as temperate, thanks to its oceanic climate. He noted the production of copper, gold, salt, and cloth, the poverty of much of the soil, and that northern Iberia was cold and rugged. Pliny, in his Natural History, wrote that from the Pyrenees to the Douro, the entire region was full of mines of gold, silver, iron, lead, and tin. He reported that gold was found in the river Tagus in the form of auriferous sands, and that Lisbon was famous for its mares, which conceive from the west wind. Pomponius Mela, who was writing in about 43 to 44 CE and came from near Gibraltar, referred to gems in the Tagus. Developments subsequently included the diffusion of new religions, such as Mithras. Judaism, an old religion, spread as a consequence of the Jewish diaspora that followed the suppression of the revolt in Palestine in 132 CE. Judaism was also diffused in the new and very different form of Christianity, which was able to spread without ethnic limits. In 312, Christianity became the official religion of the empire. It was rapidly established and left a major imprint in the cities of the later empire, where churches were built. Alcácer, Salatia, had a bishop in about 300, and Braga certainly had a bishop in around 390. The Núcleo Arqueológico in Lisbon includes the remains of a 5th-century Christian burial place. Although born in Rome, Pope Damasus I, ruled 366 to 384, had parents who originated in Lusitania, possibly in Aquitania. The cities of what became Portugal were heavily fortified in response to attacks from barbarians, which became serious in the 260s. In Conimbriga, a large wall was erected through the town centre. There was also political, fiscal, and economic instability within the empire itself, and Portugal briefly became part of a rebel Roman Empire based in Gaul, France, under Postumus. Aurelian, ruled 270 to 275, reunited the Roman Empire, however, and brought a measure of revival. To strengthen the administration, Diocletian, ruled 284 to 305, redrew provincial boundaries and introduced a system of joint rule that saw Iberia linked with Italy and North Africa. This, however, did not provide lasting stability, and instead looked towards the lasting division of the Eastern and Western empires in 395. Iberia was part of the more vulnerable and less well-resourced West, and was invaded in 409 by Germanic tribes, the barbarians that had emerged in Scandinavia during the Nordic Bronze Age of 1700 to 500 BCE, before moving south, eventually forming migrating tribal entities. Roman influence in Portugal continued, but it had been fatally weakened, and as with England, political and military links with Rome were sundered in the 410s. Lisbon was ravaged by the Visigoths in 419 and was captured by the Suevi in 469. They had destroyed once impressive Conimbriga the previous year. The legacy of Rome. Although this legacy was much shadowed by barbarian conquest and its later consequences, Roman rule left Latinity, Christianity, an urban structure, and an experience of unity, as well as remains that are not only still impressive, but also helped define the imagination of Rome's successors. Archaeology has helped expand our knowledge of Roman Portugal and has provided more sites for tourists, as well as more material to consider in museums. There is still more to excavate, including at Conimbriga. Although the legacy of Roman rule was significant, it was and is far less present than in Italy or indeed Spain. Instead, like Britain, what became Portugal absorbed the Roman legacy and used it to justify its colonial rule, but rather shrugged off the administrative legacy of Roman rule, focusing instead on the long centuries of state formation in the medieval period. In the case of Portugal, this process was accentuated because it was only then, and indeed over 700 years after Roman rule ceased, that Portugal became a separate state. In contrast, the Roman period was very much one of subordination within an Iberia in which Spain was clearly dominant. Moreover, Roman Portugal did not produce emperors, as Spain did with Trajan and Hadrian. Later Portuguese writers did not devote much attention to the period of Roman rule or to the enduring legacy of Rome. So also with other aspects of Portuguese culture and today with representations of Portuguese history. Even Christianity, a key development of the Roman period, was removed from that mooring. In large part, this was because the emphasis instead was on Portuguese Christianity as the product of the driving back of the Moors. Thus, the post-Roman period of Suevi and Visigoth rule was also underplayed. Another approach would be to argue that the origins of Portugal really are 12th century and were centrally focused on this driving back of the Moors. Other countries have looked back to distant origins, most prominently Greece, and have underplayed, in contrast, the shorter process that deserves attention. This has not been the Portuguese course. Indeed, the theme of Roman rule was not really welcome, because it focused attention not only on foreign control, but also on the issue of Spanish rule, or rule as part of a Spanish-dominated Iberia, as, under the Romans, that was the pattern of administration on the peninsula. Chapter 3. Suevi, Visigoths and Moors. The Suevi. Initially, western Iberia was overrun by the invading Suevi, a barbarian people who swore fealty to the western emperor Honorius and created a sub-Roman kingdom from 410 to 585. The extent of their territories was restricted in the 450s by the expansionist Visigoths, another barbarian people, with the Suevi driven into northern Portugal and Galicia. This was an aspect of the more general jostling between peoples, a process also seen in Italy, France, England, and Scotland that is obscure, but that was important to what would later be seen as state and nation building. Later writers, keen on tracing the separation of Portugal from Spain, emphasised contrasts between the Suevi and the Visigoths. The extent of such contrasts, however, is problematic. Braga became the Suevi capital. Church synods were held in Braga in 563, 572 and 675 in order to regularise conduct. 12 bishops assisted in that held in 572. Braga had been elevated to the dignity of a metropolitan see in the mid-5th century. Relatively little, however, is known about the Suevi. The Visigoths. Affected by division, the Suevi were converted to Catholic Christianity in the 6th century, with several accounts being offered of this process. They finally merged with both the Visigoths and the local population in the late 6th century, with the last king deposed by his Visigoth rival Leovigild in 585, when Suevic or Suebic Galicia became the 6th province of the Visigothic kingdom. With the Visigoths in control of all of Iberia bar the Balearic Islands from 624, Portugal was thus again part of a larger state, albeit not now one ruled from Italy. The Visigoths continued Roman administrative structures and Latin, and renounced the Arian heresy in favour of Catholicism. The Visigothic period has left a legacy of churches and of gold and silver jewellery, although Visigothic, when applied to architecture, etc., is merely a chronological marker and not an ethnic one. It is just the date that makes these churches, arches, and so on Visigothic. Moreover, the term Visigothic was not used in this period. Instead, the identity that was being forged was Gothic, gens et patria Gothorum. Allowing for this, there are Visigothic remains in a number of museums, including that in Coimbra. At Balsamao, near the Douro, there is a Visigothic chapel, probably dating from the 6th century. It is transitional, with Corinthian columns and round arches. Based on the church, the columns of which are Visigothic, Beja has a Visigothic museum. In nearby Mertola, there is a Visigothic area and an early Christian church. Subsequently created or reworked by medieval invention, the Visigothic period also left saints, for example, the purely legendary Santa Iria, about 635 to about 653, a nun allegedly murdered as a result of her chastity, who became the patron saint of her birthplace, Tumar, and after whom the name of the town of Scalabis was changed to Santarém. However, the churches were to be seized by Moorish invaders and destroyed or transformed. Thus, a Romanesque cathedral that was begun in Edania Aveia in about 585 was transformed into a mosque. The Visigothic legacy is largely a matter of the archaeological record, and that is limited because of the relative poverty of the period, and certainly limited compared to those of the Romans and the Moors, both of whom, of course, were also in control for far longer. Aside from poverty, revenues in state and church were moved eastward to the centres of Visigothic power, notably Toledo. Moorish conquest. The rapid fall of Iberia to Moorish invaders in and after 711 was one of the many dramatic successes by the forces of Islam. Explanations in Christian Iberia of its fall were for long religious, providential, and moral. God testing his people, as well as the coming of Antichrist, were key themes. There was also a theme of judgment in a story of rape, revenge, and betrayal, in which a rape by Roderick, the last king, played a central role. In practice, Visigothic failure was due to Muslim strengths as well as Visigothic disadvantages, notably divisions and other military commitments, including that against the recalcitrant Basques. Crossing the Strait of Gibraltar in 711 as part of a much wider process of Islamic expansion that also soon after took Islamic forces up against the Chinese, the Moors defeated and killed Roderick that year or the next, following up by rapidly taking over most of Iberia. The Moors pressed on to invade France, where, in contrast to northwestern Iberia, the south provided readily accessible targets. Initially successful, they were, however, heavily defeated at Tours in 732 or 733, with the crucial loss of leaders, and were driven out of France, losing the major city of Narbonne in 759. Meanwhile, the Cantabrian mountains had helped make the north, more particularly the northwest of Iberia, difficult for Muslim attackers to access, and had thereby provided refuge for the Christians. This refuge served as the foundation for a medieval Christian Portugal and Spain that were defined by war with the Moors, and both based for long in the north. At the same time, the inhospitable lands of the north were of only limited interest to the Moors. In contrast, having been exploited for taxation and labour, much of the Christian population in the Muslim areas eventually adopted Muslim culture and language. The extent of early Islamicization is a matter of controversy, however, and there were relatively few places to worship Islam. The process of Islamicization appears to have escalated in the 10th century. Moorish rule. Islamic Spain was ruled by the Umayyad Caliphate of Cordoba, and its wealth was focused in the south, notably in the valley of the Guadalquivir. Cordoba had its heyday in the mid-10th century, under Abd al-Rahman III, ruled 912 to 961, and his impressive successor as caliph, al-Hakam II, ruled 961 to 976.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.